have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream.
South African police force these miners into an area with razor wire. Then they box them in using armored vehicles. Then this happened.
Whether they were coerced, whether they charged, it's still up for debate, but police opened fire, and what we have now for the latest death counts is 34 dead and 78 injured.
For humans to advance, the price of admission has always been pain. Pain leads to suffering. Suffering leads to a new understanding. New awareness. But I didn't always think this way. Meet Steve Kallies, born into what most people in Canada would call a normal, average family during the winter months of 1977. This is a kid who never gave a thought outside his cozy life in the beautiful mountain town of Fernie, British Columbia. Growing up with his sister Michelle and brother Jason seemed effortless. Everything was going according to plan. But things don't always work out the way you want them to. Life was shattered in an instant when my sister passed away on the side of the highway. It was because of her I would spend the next decade acquiring the skills necessary to save lives, hoping other families could be spared the inevitable devastation of an unnecessary loss. A new life unfolded. Now I'm a husband, a father, a firefighter, and the Occupational Health and Safety Chair for the United Steelworkers Local 9346. Three generations of miners. Maybe four. Everything was going according to plan.
Steelworkers Health and Safety, Steve here.
Hi Steve, how's it going?
Hey Alex, I'm good, how are you?
Good. Hey, Steve, do you remember the discussion that we had about the globalization of unions and the need to export our health and safety standards around the world?
I do.
Well, I just got off the phone with Steve Hunt, and we were having a discussion about you.
What's going on?
We're sending you on a health and safety mission to Mozambique on the east coast of Africa.
Yeah, sure you are.
Before I knew it, I was on a plane to London, England. It was a long 9-hour flight, so I decided to do a little research. London, the epicenter of old empire. A truly global empire, built on the back of the 6,000-year-old slave trade. Before its North American abolition in 1863, millions of men, women, and children were abducted from Africa and forced onto ships to make the journey to the New World. Many never made it. Welcome to London. I was on a 7-hour layover, but my only experience there would consist of an uncomfortable sleep on what amounted to be a park bench. I woke up with barely enough time to catch my connecting flight to Johannesburg, South Africa. I settled in for another long flight. South Africa. Apartheid ended in 1994, Mandela released, but some wounds never heal. Lawnmen, South Africa 2012, 34 dead, 78 wounded, 260 arrested and charged with public violence. Johannesburg International Airport, disguising a massive sea of political unrest behind a facade of extreme wealth. It was here that I would connect with the rest of the international delegation. Meet Dr. Judith Marshall, facilitator and organizer for our mission to Mozambique. A tireless fighter for human rights worldwide. Philippe Bellanger, a local union leader from Quebec. No trip to Mozambique is complete without a charismatic Frenchman. Gerson Castellano. The chemical manufacturing company he works for in Brazil was recently bought out by mining giant Vale. Bobby Marie, community leader. Witness to the end of South African apartheid. Advocate for equality in Africa for the past 2 decades. The purpose of this group was simple. Prevent large multinationals from simply exploiting Mozambique's natural resources, forcing large corporations to give some of what they take. Our method: connect with local leaders, investigate communities affected by mining, educate union workers on how to negotiate in their community's best interests. Vasco da Gama rounded the Cape of Good Hope in 1498, blazing a trail up the east coast of Africa. By the 1530s, Portuguese prospectors began mining around the mouth of the Zambezi River. But constant turf wars with the Ottoman Empire prevented permanent settlement for several hundred years. By the end of the 19th century, Portuguese corporate colonization reigned supreme. The iron grip on Mozambique lasted until the 1950s, when it became a mere overseas province of a declining Portugal. The liberation movement continued to pressure the Portuguese government throughout the 60s and 70s until independence came in 1975. Far from the crowning achievement that liberation was meant to be, Mozambique spiraled into a bloody civil war, culminating in Marxist rule. An estimated 1 million souls were lost. Not until the early 1990s would civil war end and a fledgling democracy rise. A new nation born of extreme violence, still bearing the scars on its national flag.
So it's been a long trip here, about 40 hours in transit between airports, flights, layovers, waiting for buses, with about 3 hours sleep. So I'm hoping that with some more rest, we'll get some better entries. However, this is where it starts. This is where the whole exchange begins, is today.
We could have done things according to plan, but at this point, sideways seemed like the most logical option. My new friend Gerson thought it might be exciting to crash an international conference on inequality in Africa. The goal: ambush former president of Brazil, Lula, and hand deliver a report on the corporate unsustainability of Brazilian mining giant, Vale. Had I known I was part of a hit team, I would have worn my suit. Getting to Lula was easy. No one was expecting us. Having risen to power on the backs of his union brothers and sisters in Brazil, Lula was easily distracted with his former union's flag. Gerson, sensing the perfect moment to strike, stuffed the Vale unsustainability report into Lula's hands just in time for the money shot. I guess we know who wears the pants in Brazil. With just enough time for Vale execs to fix Lula's makeup and switch hats, he was off to the Mozambican Ministry of Labor. There, he would advocate on behalf of multinational mining corporations to allow the importation of temporary foreign workers, even though more than 50% of the host population is unemployed. While Lula was courting the corporate elite, we decided to check out the capital city's crumbling infrastructure. Maputo's landmark train station, built in the early 1900s. Beautiful Portuguese architecture. Neglected through decades of war. When the Portuguese were expelled in 1975, they took the city plans with them, making upkeep nearly impossible. It seemed like everything, everywhere, was falling apart.
To be honest, I'm very sad. I'm very distraught at that in today's time that large companies can operate in Canada and pretend to be morally ethic with their management styles and their treatment of people and the environment, and then come across a different line in the sand, a different border, and completely ignore those so-called moral ethics. The things that were explained to me that are happening here, people dying without any investigation at all, the environment being essentially destroyed without any recourse. It's appalling. It's frightening, to be honest. I don't know, it's midnight. I got to be up for 4:30 a.m. to catch a flight to the next city called Tete, where we'll be spending the next 6 days.
This is Tete, ground zero for our operation, some 400 kilometers inland on the Zambezi River. In recent years, this area has received a massive influx of people as Tete prepares to become the coal capital of the world. When development is complete, an estimated 37 million tons of metallurgical coal will reach the seaborne markets annually. Compare this with Canada's 25 million tons from British Columbia's Elk Valley coal mining operations. Supply and demand. These are the immutable laws of economics. With labor markets in Mozambique flooded with desperate workers and apparent lack of health, safety, and environmental standards, the impact on global coal prices could be severe. Failing global standardization of health, safety, and environment, a catastrophic fall in Canadian standards will be swift.
This is the Fort McMurray of Mozambique.
Fort McMurray of Mozambique.
Exactly, everyone says the
Mac.
Like 5 years ago, none of this was here. All of this stuff is here.
Our first stop, the Ministry of Labor to announce our presence in the area. But our appointment had been cancelled and she was nowhere to be found. Somebody had gotten to the minister before we did. Later, when we arrived at the Moieties Institute of Mining and Geology, our suspicions were confirmed. Only a handful of committed labor activists were there. Meet Paulo Olivier, renegade local union president for construction, wood and miners in the Nampula region, Mozambique. The last time I saw him was at a steelworker health and safety school in Kimberley, British Columbia. He left Canada without his certificate of completion, so we hand-delivered it. But the reunion was short-lived. Paulo had some bad news. The partnership between the Steelworker Humanity Fund and the host union, Syntesim, had finally ruptured. Any labor activist coming into contact with our international exchange would be branded by Syntesim's national office as a subversive. However, community leaders under the guidance of Vita Viva helped triage the situation. This is Fabian Manica, former Syntesim Secretary of Training and Education, fired by Syntesim for actually trying to do his job. Currently a facilitator for grassroots organization Vita Viva. We found ourselves immersed in a room full of angry citizens, unhappy with having their lives dictated to them by powerful corporations. Through reenactment, they told their story, successfully identifying some of the strategies used against them. Their situation, not unlike that of our great-grandparents back in North America 100 years ago. European colonial powers, hungry for resources, expanding across a new continent. Railways. Blazing an iron trail to the west coast. Vancouver born in 1886. 1905 saw the birth of two new Canadian provinces where none existed before. Between 1891 and 1914, over 4 million immigrants landed in Canada. America, land of the free. Between 1884 and 1912, over 1,700 miners killed in the Colorado coal seams. Dead work. Miners paid only for the coal brought to the surface. Getting to the coal alive was their problem. Lives were cheap. Men lived in company towns. Women shopped at company stores. Children remained largely uneducated. Simple company strategy. Keep them in the dark. Ludlow, Colorado, September 1913. Coal miners and their families had enough and went on strike. They wanted recognition as a union, payment for dead work, enforcement of the 8-hour workday, and better working conditions. I guess old man Rockefeller didn't see things the same way. Miners and their families were evicted from the company town. They set up a tent village off company property. The striking families survived the winter of 1913. On April 20th, 1914, company enforcers, along with the Colorado National Guard, opened fire on the tent colony, then set it ablaze. When the smoke finally cleared, between 19 and 25 people, including two women and 11 children, were dead. 2,000 kilometers north in the Rocky Mountain coal seams, the company town of Michel Natel has 1,200 inhabitants. They live and work on Crow's Nest Coal Company property. A coal boom ensues. Nearly 13,000 people flood the area, finding work in the Crow's Nest mines. Conditions were deadly. Coal Creek Collieries, May 22, 1902. 128 perish in an underground explosion. June 19, 1914. 189 miners die in the Hillcrest mine disaster. Two world wars later, the sun sets on Britannia's holdings and rises in the east. Japan is rebuilding under American occupation, desperate for coal. Kaiser of California brings new mining technology to the Crow's Nest coal field. Instead of digging into mountains, they would simply move them. Michel Natel had to go. Kaiser encouraged residents to move to nearby Sparwood, only 5 kilometers away. The last homes were bulldozed in 1978, and the town of Michel Natel vanished. Today, the town of Sparwood, British Columbia has 4,200 residents, mostly coal miners and their families. It is also home to the United Steelworkers Local 9346.
It requires to learn new ways of organizing, new ways of communicating. That's what we're doing right now. This is actually a learning, you know, just sitting around and how we were trying to deal with this technical problem. Once we start getting it right, and once we start spreading this, so that it's not, you know, Steve and myself sitting here, those workers that I spoke to this afternoon, they can have a conversation very soon. So we got to learn new ways of organizing and you know, we can't rely on the traditional ways to bring this up.
I think what's fascinating is that over here the union movement has run aground, not necessarily because of corruption, but simply because we've done so much good work and we've changed the laws and we've established things to such a degree that some people look at it as the law of diminishing returns, that we've already achieved what we could achieve, and we have very high health and safety standards, and we've got great wages, and we've got great schools for our children. We've got institutionalized medicine for the working class. We've got retirements. We've got all this wonderful stuff. But at the same time, we're now starting to see how, unless we export those standards to the rest of the world, corporations like Vale, Rio Tinto, Teck, or any sort of corporation that's looking to increase its profit is going to turn to people in the third world, essentially in the global south, and begin importing them and replacing us as workers. And we're now actually starting to see that. We're witnessing it in British Columbia as they bring in people from places, countries that don't have rights, and they're going to bring them here, and they're not going to give them rights either. So it's almost bizarre to see that we're being sort of pushed aside and marginalized because we have health and safety standards and we have rights. And so from our perspective over here, we desperately need to connect with the rest of the world and say, hey, we've got to all work together and orchestrate some global standardization here before we end up with nothing. And I don't think people here realize how fragile, you know, our standards are. They're only as good as the people willing to stand up and fight for them.
Yeah, and I think what you guys are doing in just this communication that we're having, right? You guys are learning how to be doing this. It's not just simply getting on a plane and sitting in a conference. It's learning how to make this communication. And once you get that right, and you know, the other point is a kind of founding principle of a trade union. What makes a trade union different from a business organization is that it's not just simply about yourself, it's about all workers. You know, the slogan, injury to one is an injury to all. It's what has made the trade union different and what's the basis of solidarity.
While we were busy through the night establishing global communications, down the hall from us, Jerrison had an unwelcome knock at his hotel room door. Three ominous men had a message for him. They reminded him how far he was from home and showed him how vulnerable he was in Mozambique. Unwilling to jeopardize the spirit of our mission, Jerrison remained silent.
All access 9346. Here we are, day 3 of the conference, Wednesday. Finally had a good sleep. Feeling good. Looking forward to the day.
We had a major challenge on our hands. The communities were in disarray. Bobby Marie of Benchmarks led with community mapping, allowing communities to pinpoint their problems. They quickly realized they had much in common. They could then list their concerns.
Trying to remember them all and thinking about them, when it gets put down on paper and you can make a list of what the problems are, you can start to work in order to solve them.
Once a prioritized master list was compiled, they would need to learn how to broadcast their shared concerns to everyone in the local area. Cell phones and internet provided the solution. Social media would be the mechanism for local unity. And later provide the path to global solidarity.
I've never seen so much joy in so many people. It was overwhelming. So we'll looking forward to having the chance to go to Rio Tinto today, hopefully, and see what we can find out there.
Rio Tinto. All access 9346. Denied. It seemed as though they had something to hide. Perhaps it was the families literally living on the edges of their operations. Exposed to fly rock and poisonous gas from blasting. Corporate social responsibility at its finest. We quickly moved on to investigate other communities displaced by mining. At the resettlement of September 25th, Valet was nice enough to string power lines to the village, but ironically left the people unemployed. With no means to purchase electricity, progress would hang just beyond reach. Welcome to Katami. A 2-hour drive from the September 25th resettlement. The crown jewel of Valet's resettlement program in Mozambique.
Quando nós saímos, tínhamos escola de pão a pique. Agora aqui temos escola melhorada.
Images released by Valet on the internet show a picture-perfect example of the successful resettlement.
Dentro da estação conhecimento, que faz parte do programa social da Vale, existe uma componente virada ao apoio técnico ao processo produtivo das famílias daqui de reassentamento de Katemi. Esse processo de apoio técnico inclui fornecimento de insumos melhorados.
An achievement any Valley executive would be proud of.
Objetivo que foi feito como este em toda a...
Just what Valet wants investors to believe. When we arrived at Katami, it was a different story. It was like a ghost town. The land was totally barren. Their only source of water, unreliable at best. Poorly constructed houses were falling apart.
But in fact, the cement that's been poured around the edge of the house is just that. It's just there's no cement. This cement slab doesn't continue under the house. So the rest of the actual house is just sitting on earth, whereas this sort of border here is the only thing that was actually poured. And then you can see a bit of they did a bit of a repointing here right at the edges, which was supposed to be, this is what they claimed was the upgrade or rehabilitation of the original house that was built, which was already falling apart. So what they've done is put a little cement border around and painted the house rather than addressing any of the fairly serious structural issues that these houses have. They're crumbling.
There were no tractors or other farm implements. The only thing resembling any of Valet's propaganda was a small garden surrounded by fence held under guard. We managed to distract the guard long enough to catch a glimpse of the modern farming technology, hailed by valet as a solution to hunger in Africa. A pop bottle with a hole in the lid. More guards arrived quickly and shuffled us from the scene. After witnessing the valet spectacle, it became clear. The people of the resettlements of September 25th in Katami, among others in the area, were once part of a larger community. Valet had simply found something in Mozambique they wanted, but this community stood in its way. The town was pulled from its roots, its branches divided, then scattered across the land. It's the oldest trick in the book. Divide and conquer. Valet is set to make billions and repay the host population it has destroyed with pop bottles. Some say unions have done their job already, that they are obsolete in today's modern age. But as long as billions of consumers demand more for less, and as long as there are corporations willing to do anything to serve them, I say, our job has just begun.
Saying man made out of mud, poor man's made out of muscle and blood, muscle and blood, skin and bones, a mind that's weak and a back that's strong. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. Saint Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. Born one morning when the sun didn't shine, picked up my shovel and I went to the mine. Loaded 16 tons of Tennessee coal. The straw boss said, well, bless my soul, you load 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.